So in this session, we will discuss about N minus 1 failure criteria and what is its importance, why it is used in power system. Basically, N minus 1 criteria is for the reliability study of power system, and this in the simple or simplest of the word, N minus 1 criteria means out of N number of elements, even if one element fails at one particular point of time, then the fault clearance must not hampers. So now we will see what is this N minus 1 criteria, how it is implemented inside the substation in any electrical utility. Okay. So first of all, we know that in any electrical system, we cannot overrule the chances of fault anywhere, either it is a transmission line, transformer, that is ICT, reactors or bus bar. We always have some or other kinds of faults. Now in case of transmission line, we know that because the line is most of the time exposed to the outside environment, and there are the high chances of different kinds of fault, like line to ground, line to line, or triple line to ground. Similarly, in transformer, reactors and bus bar, there are chances of the fault. Like in transformer and reactor, the chance faults may be the inter-turn faults or the fault due to failure of insulation or mechanical damages. So we cannot overrule the chances of fault. But the main thing or the main purpose of the protection system is to isolate this fault as quickly as possible. Protection system must isolate these faults as quickly as possible. Now, to isolate these faults as quickly as possible, the first thing that we need is a protective relay. And second thing, a protective relay, after detecting the fault, it sends the signals to circuit breaker, and circuit breaker, after receiving this signal from protective relay, it opens and clears the fault. Circuit breaker opens and clears the fault. This is the basic philosophy inside every protective scheme. But before this, now our relay determines the fault on the basis of its algorithm, and this algorithm may be based on current, based on voltage, or based on the any combination of this current and voltage, like the ratio between voltage and current to form impedance, admittance, or the power factor, power angle. So there may be any different types of algorithm that we can have inside this relay. Now for any algorithm, this relay must need the input signal from this current and voltage. For sending this input signal from current, we need a measuring device which measures this current, and this measuring device to measure the current is CT. And second, for voltage, we use PT or CVT, capacitive voltage transformer. So what comes before this relay is your CT and CVT. So CT and CVT measures the current and voltage continuously and send this signal to relay. Relay, after detecting this current and voltage signals, if there is any abnormality, and how it determines abnormalities, by simply its algorithm. Like if current is coming from CT, and if this current is more than the set value, then it detects it as an overcurrent and relay will operate. Similarly, from CVT, if voltage is dropping to some value that is under voltage, and relay will operate. Or the ratio V by I, if it is more than some value, set value, then relay will operate. Or V by I is less than some value, then relay will operate. Depends upon what kind of algorithm we are using. Now this is one thing, but this relay, after detecting a fault on the basis of its algorithm, it have one output contact, and this output contact is used to trigger this circuit breaker for clearing the fault. Now this output contact is basically a simple mechanical contact, or simple electrical contact, by the way. And this electrical contact is wired from DC voltages, and now it is connected to circuit breaker. Now, up to this point, if we see that if this contact does not operates, then what happens? Even if the relay detects the fault correctly, but since this contact is not operating by because of any reason, then the fault will not be cleared. Similarly, if this relay fails to operate, then the fault will not be cleared. So up to this point, there are chances that the failure of even a single element will lead to non-clearance of fault. So what we need, we have to duplicate each and everything. So in actual system, we have two relays, relay 1 and relay 2. And these relay are generally of this same type. For example, for transmission line, these relay 1 and relay 2 will be, suppose, impedance type relay. The algorithm may be different in both relays. For example, this relay is by manufacturer A, or this relay is by manufacturer B, and they use different types of algorithm for measuring the impedance, but these both relay are impedance type relay. Now, the output contact of first relay and output contact of second relay is wired to the circuit breaker for clearing the fault. But here comes one important thing. We cannot duplicate the breaker, because if we want to duplicate the breaker for reliability, then the cost of this scheme will be very, very high. So the only thing that we can duplicate is, since we cannot duplicate the breaker, the next somewhat lower comes is the mechanism system of breaker. But we cannot duplicate mechanism system also. So what we can duplicate is the tripping coils. That's why if you see any circuit breakers, you will have trip coil 1 and trip coil 2. There are two different trip coils. Now, relay 1 is feeding to trip coil 1, relay 2 is feeding to trip coil 2, and for better designation, relay 1 is fed from DC source 1 and relay 2 is fed from DC source 2. So that if DC source 1 fails, then this path will not lead to clearance of fault, but since DC 2 is healthy and relay 2 operates, so it will clear the fault through TC1 of the breaker. Now, behind this, there are CT and CVT. Once again, we cannot duplicate the CT, but we can have two different cores of a single CT. Suppose this is core 1 of CT, then we will have core 2 of CT here. So that if there is any problem in core 1 of CT, this path will not detect the faults, but core 2 is healthy. We are assuming that only there is one single failure. We are not assuming multiple failures. So if core 1 is failed, core 2, we are assuming that it is healthy. So this path, core 2 is healthy. CT measurement is accurate. Relay detects the fault. And from DC 2, it will energize trip coil 2 and it will clear the fault. Similarly, if it is an impedance relay, we will have CVT also. Here also we have CVT. And this will have, suppose, core 1. And this is, suppose, core 2. Now, this DC 1, DC 2 is basically, if you zoom this DC 1, basically what DC 1 is, this is a 220 volt battery system with independent battery chargers. That means, now our complete scheme comes out like this. This is 220 volt battery system 1 plus battery charger 1, 220 volt battery system 2 plus battery charger 2. Now it will feed to relay 1, which is incidentally called main 1 for transmission line, or maybe differential relay for transformer. Then second, battery charger 2 and DC volt 2, it will feed to relay 2, and this will be main 2 of transmission line, or maybe REF protection of transformer and reactor. Now this relay will energize trip coil 1 through 86.1. this is called master trip relays, and we will discuss about this in later sessions, why 86.1 is used and why there is no direct wiring from main 1 to circuit breaker tripping coils in main 2 to circuit breaker tripping coils. Secondly, from main 2 86.2, this is again master trip relay set 2, master trip relay set 2, and now this is connected to trip coil 1, this will be connected to trip coil 2, obviously of the same circuit breaker, and this is your circuit breaker. Now this relay is now having input from CT, suppose core 1, and CVT, suppose core 1, if it is for line protection. Similarly, this relay also CT core 2 and CVT core 2 if it is for transmission line. If it is for ICT and reactor, then only we will have CT from two different cores. Now if you see, in case there is a failure of in any one element, suppose battery system 1 fails, then this path will not clear the fault, but we will have the clearance of fault from battery set 2, relay 2, 86.2 and trip coil 2. Similarly, if there is any failure of suppose trip coil 2, then fault will be cleared through this path. If there is a failure of 86.1, then also this path will clear the fault. Likewise, we have the reliability, in this case we have a reliability of n-1, and why it is called n-1, how many number of elements we have here, 2 plus 1 3 to 5 6 7 into 2 14. Out of these 14, if there is a failure of any one elements, if there is a failure of any one out of these 14, fault will be isolated. We will limit ourselves up to this point only, because when we discuss about the protection system in details, then we will discuss some more things, why these wires are connected first to 86.1 and then from 86.1 to tripping coils, and in some cases why some wires are terminated directly from main 1 main 2 relay to tripping coils, some wires are connected through some auxiliary relays, and why these schemes are made like that. This will be discussed in later sessions. Similarly, we will discuss about PLCC and why PLCC, in that PLCC we have N-1 criteria, and how this PLCC N-1 criteria is different from all other N-1 criterias. I hope this will be of some help up to this point. Thank you, and in the next session we will continue from this onwards.